Namaste. Welcome to the next video of Machine Learning Techniques course. In this video, we'll discuss how to fix the overfitting problem in the polynomial regression. In the last video, we demonstrated the problem of overfitting in polynomial regression model with higher degrees. On your screen, you can see the polynomial regression model, which is showing slight overfitting tendency with a model of degree 7. So you can see that one of the signature of the overfitting is a very large weights are assigned to some of the higher order terms. So for example, this W5, W3, W6, W4, they have relatively larger weights that are assigned compared to the other weights. And in case of W4, these are large negative weights. In case of W5 and W3, these are large positive weights. So these arbitrarily large weights cause the models to overfit. And we talked about a couple of ways to address the overfitting problem. The first was, bringing in larger amount of training data for fixing the overfitting. And second is, controlling the model complexity through regularization. Let's look at how we can fix the overfitting problem with more data. Here, we train a polynomial model of degree 9 on two data sets, one with 15 points and second with 100 points. You can see on the left hand side, the model fit to the training data with 15 points. Of course, the model is of degree 9. And on your right, you see the same model that we fit with 100 examples or 100 points. You can observe that the fit in the right hand side pane is much smoother than the one on the left. So this concretely demonstrates that if you bring in more data, we can control the problem of overfitting. Because when we bring in more data, even if model has got more capacity compared to the lower order polynomial model, they just cannot memorize all the points. Because now we have more points and models do not have that much of capacity to remember all the points. Hence, getting more data helps us to control the overfitting problem. The second way of controlling the overfitting problem is by using regularization. We discussed that overfitting is caused by larger weights assigned to the higher order polynomial terms. In regularization, we add a penalty term in the loss function. So let's modify the loss function. So what you see on your screen right now is an equation for the modified loss function. It contains the loss term from the classical linear regression model, and we add a penalty term with a multiple lambda, which controls how much penalty is to be added to the loss function. If lambda is 0, then effective penalty is 0, and we get a loss function which is exactly same as the linear regression loss function. Whereas if lambda is infinity, the amount of penalty that we add overpowers the term on the left, and we essentially get very high bias models. We'll see the changes or how the model fitment changes with different values of lambda in a few slides. So as you can see, regularization has modified the loss function, and since we modified the loss function, we use the partial derivative of the loss function with respect to the weight vector in gradient descent computation. So the partial derivative will also change because we have a modified loss function, and that will also result in change in the update rule in the gradient descent procedure. There are two components of regularization. One is the penalty term and second term is the regularization rate. Penalty term is a function of weight vector. As we increase the magnitude of certain components in the weight vector, the penalty goes up. And the regularization controls the amount of penalty to be added to the loss function. There are three types of regularization. One is L2 regularization that leads to a ridge regression model, then L1 regularization that leads to lasso regression model, and then combination of L1 and L2, which is called elastic net regularization. We'll study ridge and lasso regression in detail in this particular course. Let's look at ridge regression. Ridge regression uses L2 regularization, that means it uses the second norm of the weight vector as a penalty term. So on your left, you see, so this is the loss function, and the term before the plus sign is the term that we also encounter in linear regression model. Plus we add a penalty term. This lambda is a regularization rate, and the penalty is computed by taking the square of individual weights and summing them across all the weights. So we have m plus 1 weights. We actually ignore the bias unit from this penalty term, and we sum up from I equal to 1 to m. This can be written in a vectorized form as follows. So this particular second norm of the weight vector can be written as W transpose W. So we have written the loss function, the modified loss function in a vectorized form. And remember that this particular left hand side term is exactly like what we have in linear regression. And now we have added a new term, which is a penalty term based on the second norm of the weight vector. As we said earlier, since we add the penalty term to the loss function, this leads to the change in the gradient calculation with respect to the weight vector. So we have written the steps in the gradient calculation. These steps are exactly like the gradient calculation in linear regression, except for the penalty term that is added over here. And remember the mathematical trick that we applied to get the term exactly in this particular form. So we made sure that this particular term can be written in this particular form, just like in linear regression model. Next, we bring in this partial derivative operator inside the bracket and apply it on individual terms. So after taking the partial derivative, using the rules that we studied earlier during the linear regression and performing some algebraic manipulation, we obtain the partial derivative of loss function with respect to weight vector as x transpose xw minus x transpose y plus lambda w. So remember this particular form, the first part of the equation x transpose xw minus x transpose y is exactly same as the linear regression. So now we add a penalty term, we add the partial derivative of the penalty term, which is lambda w, to this particular gradient calculation. We can obtain the weight vector again using one of the two methods, either using normal equation or with gradient descent. In case of normal equation, we set the partial derivative of loss function with respect to the weight vector to 0 and we solve for W. When we set the partial derivative to 0 and then solve for W, we end up with W equal to x transpose x plus lambda I. This I is the identity matrix, and then we take inverse of the quantity, the resulting matrix in the bracket, and we multiply that with x transpose y. You can see that this particular equation, the normal equation, is same as the linear regression normal equation, except that the term lambda I is added inside this particular bracket. Now you can see that if we use lambda equal to 0, that is a no regularization case, we end up with an equation W is equal to x transpose x inverse x transpose y, which is exactly the same as the linear regression solution. And when we use lambda equal to infinity, we get W equal to 0, which is infinite regularization, which is again a very, very high bias solution. Let's derive the gradient descent update rule for ridge regression. So the new value of the weight vector, it's set to the old value of the weight vector minus alpha times, alpha is the learning rate, times x transpose, x is the feature matrix, we take the transpose of the feature matrix, into xw minus y. Xw is the predicted output vector or label vector minus the actual label vector, and we add the partial derivative of the penalty term, which is lambda times w. So again, we simply add this lambda w as an additional term to the gradient descent update rule of the linear regression models. So let us study the effect of regularization rate lambda. So you can see that we have tried different regularization rates here, starting from a very small regularization rate to a large regularization rate. So you can see that when we have a very small regularization rate, our model is kind of overfitting, and as we increase the regularization rate, the model fit becomes better and eventually it starts underfitting. So we have a synthetic data set or a sample data set where we have a single variable x1, and the output label y is calculated as a sine of 2 pi times the value of the feature. And we are trying to fit the model, which is shown by the red line. And depending on the regularization, so here we are trying to fit the polynomial model of degree 9 or of order 9 with different regularization rates. You can see that as the value of lambda increases, the regularization rate increases, the model loses its capacity, and eventually for very large values of lambda, the model underfits the data. Got it? So we do not want to use too small value of lambda or too large value of lambda as a regularization rate, but we need to figure out, we need to strike a balance between these two situations, these two extremes of underfitting and overfitting. We started using regularization to address overfitting, but if we add too much of regularization, there is a risk of model underfitting the data. So let's try to figure out how to choose the regularization rate lambda. So we use the following procedure to choose lambda. So first we construct set of values of lambda that we want to experiment with. Then for each candidate value of lambda, we train the model and calculate cross-validation error on validation set. And this cross-validation error, we can use any error matrix of our choice. We can use the loss, or we can use RMSE as an error measure. Then we choose the value of lambda which results in the least cross-validation error. With the chosen value of lambda, we train the model on the entire training set. Remember, in the second step, we were doing cross-validation. That means we were dividing the training set into or partitioning the training set into k partitions. And in cross-validation, as you know, we use k minus 1 sets for training and the remaining set for calculating the cross-validation error. So once we choose the value of lambda, we use the entire training set for training the model with that chosen value of lambda. And then we report the performance of the model on the test set. So we have shown a sample run of the model or of the procedure that we just described for choosing the value of lambda. So on x-axis we have values of lambda. So they go from smaller values of lambda to the larger values of lambda. And on y-axis we have the measure of the error or the cross-validation error. Typically, a bow chart has a bowl-shaped appearance. However, due to small number of features and samples, here the chart is not exactly bowl-shaped. It can be approximated with a bowl-shaped function, but it is not exactly bowl-shaped. The most appropriate value of lambda results in the lowest cross-validation error. So in this case, the most appropriate value of lambda seems to be 0.1. So let's look at another type of regularization, which is called as L1 regularization, that gives us lasso regression model. So here the only change from L2 regularization is that instead of using the second norm of the weight vector, we use the first norm of the weight vector. And the first norm is calculated by summing up the absolute values of the individual weights. Again, we take weights from W1 to Wm for this calculation. However, the lasso regression model, because of this penalty term, the resulting loss function is not differentiable at all points. Hence, we need specialized optimization algorithm to estimate weight vector in lasso regression. And these algorithms are beyond scope of this course. We'll use a scalar implementation of lasso in machine learning practice course, and we'll see some of the examples, practical examples of solving the machine learning regression problems with lasso.